In terms of differential diagnosis of apnea, we have apnea of prematurity as a diagnosis of exclusion. The reason we say this, even though it's the commonest reason, we shouldn't miss any serious underlying conditions. So in the first day or two, we can consider peripartum factors like maternal sedation, use of magnesium. Intrapartum asphyxia can contribute as well. Hypoglycemia, early onset sepsis may all lead to apnea. Respiratory distress, in a baby with respiratory distress, the apnea might indicate worsening disease and the need for either surfactant therapy or increasing pressure with either CPAP or NIV. So don't ignore apnea which is happening in a baby who is acutely having respiratory distress syndrome, because this is an indication that you need to act. Don't delay your action, because the more you delay, the more you're going to worsen the condition. So act promptly and do the appropriate management. Temperature instability, intraventricular hemorrhage, sepsis, NEC, pneumonia, reflux we mentioned, and electrolyte disturbances, everything can contribute to secondary apnea. So the investigation would depend on the presentation and the differential diagnosis. Consider sepsis screen, blood glucose, electrolytes, chest and abdominal X-ray, and cranial ultrasound. It's a tricky balance how to avoid over-investigation and at the same time not missing out serious conditions like sepsis, because in a well baby who suddenly has apneic episodes, a growing premature baby, you would be surprised that we do pick up late onset sepsis. The baby has not had any central line for a period. We are just giving CPAP or high flow and suddenly the baby starts going limp and apnea is the first presentation. At the same time, remember that a baby who has apnea due to reflux or some factors like that, whenever the hypoxia sets in, the baby becomes hypotonic. So they do look the same, and it's reasonable that if there is no other sign of infection, you try, if they are on high flow or CPAP, you try re-recruiting the lung volume, because if you miss out re-recruiting the lung volume, the vicious cycle starts. They keep getting repeated apneic episodes because they have lost their functional residual capacity. We will discuss that in the management part as well. So this is one clue. If there are other vital signs and the responsiveness don't suggest any serious infection, you can wait 1 to 2 hours with an increased pressure on whatever mode they are getting. Even the nursing staff can be authorized to do that so that there is no delay in this. And it's usually safe to increase the CPAP by 1 centimeter or so, or if you are on high flow, you can increase by 2 to 3 liters flow. And once the baby re-recruits the lung volume, if it is pure apnea or due to reflux or something, it will start, baby will pick up, baby will start looking better. You don't need to over-investigate. However, if the baby still stays quiet, you do need to progress with investigations. Very rarely we need ENT review if you consider an airway problem. And reflex workup is not used routinely. Even in the severest cases, we may treat empirically if you do decide to treat after all the available options have been exhausted. Very rarely seizures can be presenting, and EEG may be needed to rule out a neurology consultation as well. In terms of monitoring, all of us are familiar with the monitoring tools, and pulse oximetry is a standard. Obviously, we have the saturation and the heart rate, and these are the two parameters which happen with significant apnea. So monitoring the breathing rate or the actual cessation of breathing is not essential. Desaturation with a drop in heart rate should be enough for you to pick up apnea in a self-ventilating or in a baby on non-invasive ventilation. You can look at the breathing pattern after that, and you can corroborate the pattern of apnea and the underlying causes. The thoracic impedance monitoring with the ECG leads, it gives you the heart rate and rhythm as well as the respiratory rate. So obviously it's not very sensitive and movement artifacts are not uncommon. So we also have the apnea monitor using a Grace B capsule. This usually is in the abdominal wall and uses the breathing movement. So that again is not going to be that helpful, and you may have false positives as well. So people used a grading approach. I mean, the pulse oximeter and the ECG leads are both used in the acute phase when the infant is sickest. When they are relatively stable, you keep them just on the saturation monitor, because this gives a reasonable indication. And when the baby is ready to transfer to the room, we change them to with no monitoring. And in some cases, you may use the Grace B capsule. But I should confess that very few units use this these days, because it's not that reliable. So most infants in the NICUs are continuously monitored anyway for the heart rate, respiratory rate, and oxygen saturation. And we discussed impedance monitoring is potentially misleading, as it's prone to artifact due to monitored body active movement. It may not detect obstructive apnea for obvious reasons as well. So when to discontinue monitoring, we discussed as well. So there is no data to suggest that a diagnosis of apnea of prematurity is associated with increased risk. So I briefly mentioned it in the early stages. routine home monitoring for preterm infants with resolved apnea of prematurity is not recommended. So many of us face anxious parents. When we were in UK, we used to face this regularly. The parents used to ask, and that was one of the reasons we had the apnea monitors, which we used to give them home. They were warned about the false alarm and that it may not pick up all serious episodes as well. In the sickest babies with BPD, for example, when they're discharging home after a prolonged period on oxygen, for example, we sometimes loan a pulse oximeter home with the proper education on CPR and what to do and so on. That is the extreme situations, and this happens only in the extreme premature babies. So majority of the babies do not need a home monitoring, and it's like home tube feeding. We don't need that for the majority of cases, and where you do need it, you need to put a lot of thought, a lot of training, so you don't need to overdo it. In terms of the clinical course, we have increasing frequency over the first 1 to 2 weeks in most of the cases, and more than 50% of the very low birth weight and almost all of the extreme low birth weight will need treatment for apneic episodes. Majority of the clinically significant episodes resolved by 36 weeks post-conceptional age, and mostly these babies are home by 36 to 37 weeks anyway. So we should, once they go home, we should remember that RSV infection, vaccination, or any surgery like hernia, for example, which happens often in these babies, increases the risk of apnea in the ex-premature baby. So you may need to monitor them closely after any such incident. Of course, most units do not practice hospitalization to monitor, but we want the parents. Surgery, of course, we may need to consider keeping these babies in the ICU for a period of time, 24 hours or so post-surgery is a period when the highest risk is there. And RSV, we all know the role of palivizumab. We use it for selected babies and in a resource-limited setting like in some parts of India. I'm not sure how we are using this, but it has to be used only in the most high-risk cases, obviously. In Henderson Smart study on apnea, the spells stopped by 37 weeks postmenstrual age in 92% and by 40 weeks in more than 98%. The infants with BPD may have a delayed maturation of the respiratory control, and this may prolong the apnea for as long as 2 to 4 weeks beyond term. It's more common in the 24 to 26 weekers. The more severe episodes resolve first, and the very brief bradycardic episodes of uncertain clinical significance may resolve later. We also have a very detailed collaborative home infant monitoring evaluation study, studied more than 1,000 preterm and healthy term infants monitored at home. And they confirmed that extreme events where the apnea lasted more than 30 seconds or heart rate less than 60 beats for more than 10 seconds was observed most frequently in former preterm infants, very rarely in term infants. And they decreased dramatically till 43 weeks when they almost disappeared. And as I said, the SIDS mostly happens in a premature baby after 47 weeks and in a term baby around 51, 52 weeks. So the 3 months to 4 months cutoff for the SIDS, and it doesn't correlate with apnea of prematurity contributing to that.